Manila Mayor Isko Moreno takes a swipe at the potential presidential bid of Davao Mayor Sara Duterte.
The National Police starts using body cameras during operations.
Hong Kong authorities arrest an organizer of a vigil marking the anniversary of the bloody 1989 crackdown in Tiananmen Square.
And U.S. President Joe Biden expands a Trump-era ban on American investment in Chinese firms.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Karen Davila.
On our broadcast tonight, the mayor of Manila opposing the rise of new political dynasties in the Philippines. Isko Moreno says officials should not treat their posts as something to be handed down to family members. Moreno's remarks a veiled repudiation of the reported plan by President Duterte's daughter to seek the presidency next year. RG Cruz has tonight's top story.
Neither Manila Mayor Isko Moreno nor Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte have officially bared their plans for the 2022 presidential elections. But Manila's chief executive has this to say against his Davao City counterpart. Both of them figured well in recent pre-election surveys for the presidency.
Ayaw kong pangunahan ng taong bayan sa pagpili nila na kanilang leader. But I hope they will not be called stupid later on. Hindi ako naniniwala na ang posisyon sa gobyerno minamana. In a democratic government. Ang demokrasya, ang taong bayan ang pumipili. Hindi ipinipilit yung mga kalahi niya pagkatapos niya na.
But for Mayor Duterte's ally, former Camarines Sur Representative Rolando Andaya Jr., Mayor Duterte is not like her father. He also ruled out a father-daughter tandem.
She is her own person. She has the name, she has the brand of Duterte. But you have to consider, she grew up under the tutelage of the mother. Ibang klase ito. Ito ay vitamin fortified na Duterte.
But Andaya believes President Duterte will support his daughter should she decide to seek the presidency.
He was actually challenging this person months before when the president said hindi pang babae ang trabaho na to. That was not something meant to discourage or to tell Sara, do not run for president. It was actually a father challenging his daughter, hindi pang babae to.
Center for People Empowerment in Governance Chairperson Dr. Temario Rivera, meanwhile, doesn't think Mayor Duterte will agree to run alongside her father.
Kung tutuloy si Mayor Sara na presidente, ano ang mangyayari sa posibleng tandem? No? Very unlikely naman na magiging tandem si Mayor Sara at ang kanyang tatay, no?
Okay.
Palagay ko Mayor Sara will be uncomfortable herself.
Okay.
At sa tingin din ng botante, masyadong garapal na yon, no?
Mayor Duterte has also rejected calls by her father's party mates to join the ruling party, PDP Laban. She is a member and leader of Davao-based political parties. Like Albay, Representative Joey Salceda, Andaya believes Mayor Duterte's presidential run is a foregone conclusion.
Well, she decided yes, but let her give her the space, give her the time to announce it in public. I know it, I have first-hand information, so I'm with them, that she is very much, or she is interested.
Andaya also reads a symbolic meaning to the COVID-19 jab that former Defense Secretary Gilbert Teodoro got in Davao. He believes Mayor Duterte intended Teodoro to be her running mate.
And that vaccine shot was very clear to us. Sara Duterte was trying to make or challenging Gilbert Teodoro be my poster boy in this problem that I'm facing now, the rising cases of COVID-19 in Mindanao. Be my poster boy, be my partner, be my vice president. Are you up to task? And he said yes. Now, if she had offered that to others, then maybe we could say na pare-pareho lang.
Mayor Isko Moreno, for his part, says he's certain about running in the 2022 elections, but has not decided on which position.
Well, ganito. Busy ako sa pagka-mayor. May obligasyon ako sa mga taga-Maynila. I would rather focus on that until the last day na magdidesisyon ako. And I'm going to be fair with our people. I'm going to be honest with our people at magpapaalam ako sa kanila. Kung ano man yon, that is remain to be seen. No? But definitely, I am running.
On Facebook, opposition leader Vice President Lenny Robredo maintained she remains open to run for president, but she also has other matters to consider. Robredo says she will make an announcement once she's reached a decision. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
A recent survey shows more Filipinos believe the worst of the pandemic is yet to come. The downbeat outlook comes as rising cases overwhelm the intensive care unit of the largest public hospital in the country. Rafael Bosano reports.
More than a year since the pandemic wreaked havoc in the country, a lot of Filipinos continue to worry about catching the dreaded disease. A survey by the social weather stations from April 28 to May 2 shows 89% of Filipinos are worried of getting the virus. The number of Filipinos who think that the worst of the pandemic is yet to come also rose. From 31% in November last year, it's gone up to 49% in May. But who wouldn't be worried, especially with a rise in infections in various regions of the Philippines? The Southern Philippines Medical Center in Davao City, the country's largest public hospital, now has a filled intensive care unit with isolation wards 98% occupied. But the hope for improvement remains after Davao City was placed under modified enhanced community quarantine beginning June 5th.
You know, we have to balance the economy also, no, and the health. So I think with that days na nabigyan sa amin, baka I can see na mag-improve siguro, makontain namin yung virus.
A health official in Region 7 meanwhile defends the test upon arrival protocol for returning overseas Filipinos in Cebu, saying it actually has benefits.
If we conduct the testing upon arrival as contained in the EO of the governor, it only means, number one, we catch the cases very early on. So kapag ka-positive, kaagad na-quarantine natin siya. Pangalawa po, we save on cost.
President Duterte earlier instructed Health Secretary Francisco Duque to critique the province's protocol. And while the agency is set to hand its recommendation to Mr. Duterte, it emphasized that the recommendations are based on scientific evidence.
Atin pa rin pong binibigay na posisyon ng Department of Health, of course, is yun pong mga napagkasunduan sa IATF, which are all based on evidence and based on science. At ito po ang ating isinusulong na maipatupad sa lahat ng rehiyon sa ating bansa para po ma-break natin ang chain of transmission nitong COVID-19.
On Friday, the Philippines logged 7,450 new infections, the highest in the past week. It also logged the fewest recoveries at 2,382 since the DOH shifted to daily time-based tagging of recoveries. For the DOH, the continued worry over the raging pandemic should be seen as an opportunity.
We would like to shift this into a positive light. They perceived na ang COVID-19 is still a risk. We can take that opportunity para mas i-encourage silang magpabakuna.
For Dr. Edsel Salvana, COVID-19 will continue to be a concern until many Filipinos are vaccinated.
Whatever happens naman, kahit bakunado na po tayo ng COVID, ang COVID kasi constantly nag-mutate, pwede magkaroon ng bagong variants. It's not something that we will say na, okay, nabakunahan na ako, tapos na to para sa akin. It may be true for you in terms of decreased severity ng illness, hindi ka na mamamatay sa COVID, pero marami pa po sa ating mga kababayan ang hindi nababakunahan.
Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Travelers who've been fully vaccinated in the Philippines against COVID will now be subjected to more relaxed quarantine and testing protocols upon entering the country. More from Pia Gutierrez.
From the original 14 days, fully vaccinated individuals arriving in the Philippines from abroad will now only be required to undergo a 7-day quarantine period. This is according to the COVID-19 Task Force, which agreed to relax testing and quarantine protocols.
Lahat ng papasok na fully vaccinated individuals ay kailangan sumailalim sa 7-day facility-based quarantine pagdating ng Pilipinas. Kailangan tiyakin ang striktong symptom monitoring habang nasa quarantine facility ng 7 araw. Pagkatapos ito, ay magse-self-monitor na ang pasahero.
According to the IATF, an individual is considered fully vaccinated at least 2 weeks after receiving their second dose of COVID-19 vaccine or 2 weeks after being administered with a single-dose vaccine. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque says these individuals will only be required to take an RT-PCR test if they manifest COVID-19 symptoms during their 7-day facility-based quarantine.
Pagkatapos makakompleto ng 7 araw sa facility-based quarantine, mag-i-issue ang Bureau of Quarantine ng quarantine certificate kung saan nakalagay ang vaccination status ng pasahero.
Roque meanwhile clarified that these relaxed protocols will only apply to individuals who have been vaccinated in the Philippines, and that Filipinos or foreign nationals inoculated abroad would still need to comply with the IATF's regular testing and quarantine protocols after arriving in the country. He says the IATF will soon release new guidelines for inbound passengers who have been vaccinated outside the country. Meanwhile, the Department of Health is studying the possibility of placing green lanes in ports and airports that would reduce the mandatory 14-day quarantine and skip COVID-19 testing requirements for fully vaccinated individuals. The DOH says these green lanes may be implemented as soon as the Philippines reaches several vaccination targets.
Ang rekomendasyon ay merong 30% sa ating mga eksperto na population coverage yung tinatawag. Pero ang isa nilang gustong ipunto rin, gusto nilang makita na at least 50% of senior citizens are also vaccinated. Walang final, ito ay mga rekomendasyon pa lang.
Meanwhile, the Philippine government has also exempted from the ongoing travel ban the repatriation efforts for Filipinos stranded in India, Pakistan, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Oman, and the United Arab Emirates, even if these were not organized by the Philippine government. The IATF says all Filipino repatriates from these countries must be able to present a negative RT-PCR test result taken within 48 hours prior to boarding the aircraft or vessel back to the Philippines. The IATF says government-organized repatriation, meanwhile, must coordinate with government agencies such as the Department of Foreign Affairs and OWA at least 48 hours before departing for the Philippines. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
5 more areas in Old Balara Village in Quezon City are placed under lockdown amid a rise in COVID cases. These areas include the streets of Ipil, Pook de la Paz, and Liwanag. The special concern lockdown was earlier imposed in Lagoon Street. The restrictions come as COVID infections in the Old Balara Village near 200.
Kung meron pong lumabas, hindi po nila iaalaw. O kaya, iaalaw po pero hindi po sila pwedeng bumalik muna ron, pansamantala. Siyempre, may tendency na pag lumabas ka ron at na-infect ka, hindi mo pa alam dahil nga hindi pa nasasagawa yung swab test sa'yo, baka makahawa ka.
Village Chairman Alan Franza says among the reasons for the infection spike was a recent aid distribution event led by a Quezon City Councilor which was attended by thousands of residents.
The United States outlines its plan to share 80 million surplus COVID vaccines with the rest of the world. The White House says 75% of the jabs will be sent to the vaccine sharing initiative COVAX. The remaining 25% will go directly to countries which America deems to be in need of the vaccines. U.S. President Biden denies the vaccines are being shared to secure favors or concessions. He says they're being given away to save lives. Of the first 25 million doses to be distributed, 7 million jabs will be sent to the Philippines and other countries in Asia.
While I wouldn't want to get out ahead of the White House and give any specific numbers or dates, I'm very optimistic that it's going to be very, very soon. We're going to be seeing vaccines in significant numbers arriving in the Philippines and in countries all around the world.
The Philippines' energy chief faces House lawmakers following recent power interruptions in parts of Luzon. Secretary Alfonso Cusi assured congressmen there's still enough power supply despite the brownouts. Zandro Ochona reports.
The Energy Department allays fears of 11-hour rotational brownouts. This after Luzon experienced a dip in power supply from May 31 to June 2, resulting to Luzon-wide outages. Speaking before the House Committee on Energy, DOE Secretary Alfonso Cusi explains several factors are to blame for the outages.
We have the capacity, but unfortunately, bumagsak na lang po yung planta. Masyadong mainit ang panahon, tumaas na bigla ang demand, sumabay ng bagsak yung mga planta po.
The Energy Regulatory Commission also said these power plants are getting older and important spare parts were either delivered late or were not delivered at all, which led to delays in their scheduled repairs.
We have noticed, Your Honors, that most plants in Luzon are 16 years and older. As power plants get older, even if we give them planned maintenance period, because they're old, they cannot be that efficient anymore.
Devanadera also said the government did not receive on time the grid operating and maintenance program schedule of power plants. But there's a glimmer of hope. With several power plants set to be back in service by July 1st, electricity consumption is also expected to go down when the rainy season arrives. Former party-list lawmaker Nery Colmenares, for his part, asserts it is time for the national government to revisit its transmission development plan to connect power plants from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao to a nationwide power grid.
Since I was a congressman researcher, I've been hearing about this transmission development plan na i-efficiently connect yung buong bansa, etc. Ano nangyari doon? Kung what happened to the Mindanao-Visayas-Luzon interconnection grid? If this interconnection project was completed on time, could it have helped avoid the lack of supply? Kasi kung it could have helped, di tapusin pala natin yan.
The committee has called on concerned government officials and stakeholders to come up with solutions to the country's energy problems. The House committee will hold another meeting on the issue at an unspecified date. Zandro Ochona, ABS-CBN News.
The United States affirms its readiness to help the Philippines in its ongoing maritime dispute with China. The assurance coming from a U.S. Embassy official in Manila. Chargé d'Affaires John Law says Philippine and U.S. officials have discussed ways to clarify and strengthen the Philippine-U.S. Visiting Forces Agreement.
Both in the previous administration with Secretary Pompeo and just recently with Secretary Blinken, the United States has reaffirmed its commitment to the Mutual Defense Treaty, made very clear that those commitments, we will uphold those, and those apply, including in the South China Sea. We know that that one of the major challenges that faces both governments is how to respond to the pressures that are coming from other actors in the region. But the United States is going to stand firmly with the Philippines on that issue.
The Philippine ambassador to the U.S., Jose Manuel Romualdez, says a revamped version of the VFA has been submitted to President Duterte. Romualdez expects Duterte to decide whether he'll scrap or extend the agreement.
Police officers in Metro Manila have started using body cameras during operations. PNP Chief Guillermo Eliazar said the move aims to prevent police abuse. But the Philippine Supreme Court has yet to issue an opinion on guidelines for the use of the gadgets. Eliazar said they can adopt the High Court's opinion when it comes out.
So sa atin po mga kababayan, may protection na kayo sa pang-abuso at kalokohan nang ilan or kukunti naming tiwaling kasamahan. At sa mas maraming bilang ng mga matitinong pulis, may proteksyon na tayo laban sa mga pagdududa at maling akala.
The National Police has been hounded with various incidents of abuse. The latest case is the cold-blooded shooting of 52-year-old Lilibeth Valdez on May 31st. The suspect, Police Master Sergeant Kenzie Zinampan, faces murder and grave misconduct charges.
The death toll in the Philippines from Tropical Storm Dante rises to 6. 2 people were injured while 3 are missing. Dante's onslaught affected over 12,260 families in the Visayas and Mindanao regions. The damage to agriculture is estimated at 63.61 million pesos. Over 1,780 farmers and fisherfolk were reeling from the agricultural loss. As of 5 p.m., the storm re-entered the Philippine area of responsibility but weakened into a tropical depression. It was last seen 210 kilometers west-northwest of Basco, Batanes. Storm signal number 1 is raised over Batanes Island. Dante is currently moving northeastward and is expected to make a landfall over southern Taiwan Friday night. Up next, Hong Kong authorities arrest an organizer of a vigil commemorating the 1989 Tiananmen Square crackdown.
And U.S. President Joe Biden bars more Chinese firms allegedly linked to the Chinese military. The World Tonight returns after the break.
Dito kami para sa'yo.
Back on the world tonight, police in Hong Kong arrest a pro-democracy activist who organized a vigil to mark the anniversary of the bloody 1989 Tiananmen crackdown in Beijing. Authorities have banned the vigil, supposedly due to pandemic restrictions. We have this report.
An organizer of Hong Kong's annual vigil marking China's 1989 Tiananmen crackdown was arrested on Friday. 36-year-old Chow Hang Tung usually helps organize Hong Kong's June 4 vigil, the world's largest vigil to mark those who died during the bloody crackdown. But this year, there will be no candles lit at Victoria Park. Police have banned the vigil for a second year in a row, citing the coronavirus. Chow told Reuters this week before her arrest that June 4th was a test for Hong Kong, of whether, quote, we can defend our bottom line of morality. Here was Chow in a commemoration march in 2019.
When it comes to the responsibility behind the June 4th incident, the real responsibility lies with Beijing's political powers. That's why we have come here to their representatives in Hong Kong.
Activists have called it a suppression of one of the city's most powerful symbols of democratic hope. On the streets, thousands of police were out on patrol to prevent people from gathering. A police official confirmed the arrest of a 36-year-old member of the Hong Kong Alliance in Support of Patriotic Democratic Movements of China and a 20-year-old food delivery man for promoting an unauthorized assembly. Friday's anniversary is the first since Beijing imposed a sweeping national security law on its freest city last year. Under the law, subversion, secession, terrorism, or colluding with foreign forces are punishable by up to life in prison. The Chinese central government says the law is vital to plug gaping holes in the city's national security defenses. But critics like Chow say it erodes the city's liberties.
It's actually a weapon of mass destruction for Hong Kong, I would say. The government always criticizes us, the activists, the pro-democracy camp for destabilizing Hong Kong. I think it's the government, it's the national security law that's destabilizing Hong Kong. It's destroying the environment of stability, of security that people have been living in.
Meanwhile, many residents said they planned on lighting a candle in their neighborhood, and some churches were open for prayer.
The United States adds 11 more Chinese firms to its blacklist of entities banned from receiving American investments. This is an expansion of a presidential order made during the Trump administration. The list now covers 59 Chinese companies with alleged links to China's military. The sanctions will begin August 2. From there, U.S. investors will have a year to divest from the listed firms. China condemns the move, accusing Washington of suppressing its companies.
A U.S. military commander condemns recent flights by Chinese military planes near East Malaysia. U.S. Pacific Air Force's commander, General Kenneth Wilsbach, warns these could lead to what he calls miscalculations in the region. The approach of 16 Chinese military planes off the coast of Sarawak prompted the Royal Malaysian Air Force to scramble its jets. Wilsbach also told reporters the U.S. is conducting reconnaissance missions in the South China Sea. He says these can give the U.S. a full understanding of Chinese activities in the region.
We'd like to know with a lot of the other, what I think is nefarious activities by the Chinese Communist Party, by taking over islands in the South and East China Sea that don't belong to them, making islands in their national water space that never belonged to them.
Myanmar sees an uptick in COVID-19 infections. Meanwhile, three Filipino workers have contracted the disease amid a raging outbreak in Taiwan. Details and other global COVID updates in this report.
Myanmar detects 122 new COVID-19 cases, its highest daily increase since the military's takeover in February. Many of the cases are from northern Chin State, which borders India. This has led to concerns the COVID-19 variant first detected in India has reached Myanmar. COVID-19 testing has collapsed in the crisis-hit country after many health workers joined the civil disobedience movement against the ruling military junta. India orders 300 million doses of a COVID-19 vaccine, which has yet to finish phase 3 clinical trials. New Delhi says the vaccine Corbevax by local firm Biological E is likely to become available in the next few months. India is struggling to vaccinate its 1.3 billion people against COVID-19 to contain a second wave of infections. Less than 10% of them have been fully inoculated so far. Japan delivers 1.2 million doses of AstraZeneca COVID-19 vaccines to Taiwan for free. This more than doubles the island's vaccine stockpile as it seeks to curb a new wave of infections. Meanwhile, the Manila Economic and Cultural Office says overseas Filipino workers with new contracts are temporarily barred from entering Taiwan due to the outbreak there.
Hindi pa rin pinapapasok muna. Although nabigyan na sila ng POEA ng kanilang work permits at meron na silang visa galing sa Taipei Economic and Cultural Office.
MECO adds, three Filipinos have been hospitalized in Taiwan due to COVID-19. All of them are workers at a semiconductor factory. One of them came from the Philippines last month. 34 of their contacts are now under quarantine. 7,000 workers at the factory where they work are undergoing COVID-19 testing.
Philippine inflation remained steady in May, reflecting the stable prices of basic commodities. The consumer price index stood at 4.5%. It's the fifth straight month that Philippine inflation breached the upper end of the government's target of 2-4% for 2021. Food and non-alcoholic beverages contributed the most to inflation at 39.5%. The Philippine Central Bank believes inflation will start to decelerate by the second half of the year, given the timely arrival of pork imports. The country's pork supply was earlier hit by a swine flu outbreak that drastically reduced the domestic hog population. A proposal to reduce tariffs for imported meat was approved by President Duterte to augment supply and bring down pork prices.
Philippine shares post a slight gains after inflation in the country remained unhinged or unchanged in May. For the week, foreign investors also became net buyers for the first time since February. Rain Musngi reports.
Philippine shares managed to end the week positive after inflation in the country remained steady in May. The main index eked out slight gains to close at 67.96. For the week, the PSEI finished higher by 1.8%. IGC Securities notes the previous week's rally of over 7% was sustained after weekly net foreign buying was registered for the first time since early February. For Aliu of RS Lim & Company, the main index is seeing steady gains.
The support has been inching up higher, so we have now higher lows, and we're expecting the market, if there's a retest again at the 7.5 levels and it consolidates further, we might see a push through past 7.8 and hopefully touching 8,000 in the coming months.
Yu says telcos, manufacturing, and tourism stocks are pulling up the market. Meanwhile, Ron Nakoba of Trading Edge sees opportunity in the financial sector.
Financial sector appears to be basing already and appears to be entering a fresh uptick as well.
Nakoba says investors will be watching for the country's debt-to-GDP ratio, which, along with the credit ratings agency's review of the country's growth, may warrant a revision of their outlook for the Philippines.
Debt-to-GDP ratio, that's going to be quite a precarious situation. We may be up for an outlook revision if we keep this trajectory of higher debt and slower GDP.
The government has no choice but to really hike up the debt to debt for them to be able to spend. That's the only way for the government to bring us out of any recession. The only way to offset that is with revenues through net imports, which we don't have, or through increase in taxes. Credit rating may actually be negatively affected.
Rain Musngi, ABS-CBN News.
Port magnate Enrique Razon has taken over the helm of the Manila Water Company a year after he acquired a controlling stake from the Ayala Group. In a disclosure to the stock exchange, Manila Water says Razon is now chairman, president, and CEO of the company after a special board meeting Thursday. Fernando Zubeldi Ayala has stepped down as chairman but remains director of the board, while his brother Jaime Augusto Zubeldi Ayala resigned as vice chairman and board director. Manila Water holds the exclusive right to provide water services to the eastern zone of Metro Manila via a concession agreement with the Philippine government. It could have exploited its business rival's unsanitary scandal, but McDonald's Philippines is denying any hand in a social media post that threw shade on the Jollibee fast food chain, which inadvertently served a deep-fried breaded towel in place of its famous chicken. McDonald's says it would not produce any material that disparages any brands. The image in question has made the rounds on social media. It features a plate of fried chicken with a caption that says, "McDonald's competitor has thrown in the towel," pun intended. Other pictures are also going viral on the net, such as this one showing the Jollibee mascot getting his blood pressure checked after supposedly hearing of the incident. This one, meanwhile, shows the alleged mastermind of the fried towel controversy in police custody. Our final word tonight is a quote from John Wooden. "Don't mistake activity with achievement."
And that is The World Tonight, the 4th of June, 2021. I'm Karen Davila.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay.